Hi, my name is Sonia, and my story is about how I became a genius and what that's really like, the good and the bad. And before we dive in, make sure you click that notification bell. Otherwise, you never know what kind of juicy stories you might miss out on. All right then. So there I was at my boyfriend, Samuel's, baseball game. It had already been a super intense match, and this was the final stretch. Samuel stepped up to bat. All of our friends were cheering around me, and I was so nervous that I nearly crushed the bag of popcorn in my hands. Funny thing, I actually don't like popcorn, but at the first game I ever went to, I was so hungry that I bought some, and Samuel's team won that game. So now it's like a good luck thing. Up went the pitcher's arm, hands on the ball. He threw it hard, but Samuel hit it even harder. That ball was going. I jumped off my seat in a fit of excitement, joining all of my friends. I was screaming so hard that I didn't even notice the ball coming right at me. Then, out of nowhere, one of Samuel's best friends snatched the ball with his ready-to-go glove right in front of my face, stopping it from smashing into me. But he bumped me while making the save. And while the ball landed softly in his glove, my head crashed hard onto the concrete steps below. Next thing I know, I'm in the hospital. Cords attached to both arms, something strapped over my face. I looked around the room, and there were cards, flowers, and balloons everywhere. Something was different from that very moment I woke up. But it felt so subtle that I almost didn't even recognize it. The simplest way to put it for those who wouldn't understand is that I was more in touch with reality, more with it. I noticed every little thing, every detail. Everything just made sense, like it never had before. Life was like a math equation, complicated, yet logical. It was peaceful. I decided to allow myself to adjust for a few days and just observe everything that was going on around me. I pretended to be asleep while my many friends and family members filtered in and out to visit. What I noticed from those visits was interesting in itself. I could see very clearly for the first time that my parents were not actually happy together. When they spoke, they never made direct eye contact, and they always had something very snippy and passive to say to one another. There was no real love or connection. I wondered why they had stayed together all those years. And then there was Samuel. He came to visit many times. To the outside world, you would think he was the most caring and devoted boyfriend ever. But the outside world didn't see the way he would smile into his phone from time to time, and only when a very specific sound would alert him of a new message. I knew right away, he was clearly cheating on me. And I'd seen that smile before, for months even. This wasn't something new. Any other time in my life, these realizations would have broken me. But now, I didn't seem to mind at all. I obviously wasn't going to let it continue with Samuel. No. I had way too much self-respect for that. But it just didn't affect me. It was like things made too much sense for there to even be those same petty human emotions. After a few days of observation and playing asleep, I decided to wake up. I figured the most convenient way to do it would be when many people were there to minimize the number of phone calls that would need to be made. So, when my parents, Samuel, and two other friends were all in the room, hanging out and talking, I opened my eyes, slowly. You know, I had to sell it. Samuel was the first to rush up to me, the very loyal boyfriend that he was. He picked up my hand and asked if I could hear him. "Yes, can you hear me?" I asked, very clearly. Maybe too clear, because he looked a bit confused. Everyone did. "Yes," he responded. "Sonia, I'm so happy." "Samuel, I'm sure you will understand why I'm breaking up with you right now," I said, cutting him off. "Won't you?" "Wait, you're breaking up with me right now?" he asked, now totally confused. "Yes, and you understand why, of course, no?" I asked. He played dumb. "Sonia, where is this coming from? Is this about the hit? Listen, I'm so sorry. You have to know I didn't mean to." I couldn't help but roll my eyes as I cut him off again. "Not the game, Sam. You're cheating on me, right?" Now, the whole room was completely still. "Sonia!" he started, clearly overacting that he was in shock. "Why would you even think such a thing?" "Give me your phone, please," I asked calmly. Of course he refused, so I tried again. "If you have nothing to hide, then give me your phone." To no surprise, he still wouldn't. And then he started to make a scene, which alerted two nurses into the room. It was clear that nothing more would come out of this conversation. He refused to leave. I asked the nurse to please take him out for my sake. As he was being walked out, he turned around, looking at me with some sort of hope. "You played a good game." I don't think he knew if I was talking about cheating or baseball at that point. It didn't matter. He turned to keep walking, and that was that. It was at that moment that something clicked inside of me. I had known Samuel was cheating on me, just by mere observation. I then realized that I could manipulate just about everything around me to have the life I'd always wanted. It would be easy, but it needed, though, to be tested. But I had to be careful. These doctors had no idea what was happening with me. It was a good thing, in a way. It doesn't take a genius to realize that if my smarts were exposed now, I'll end up in a testing facility with machines hooked up to my body going from one experiment to another. I needed to be careful, but I needed to test the potential extent of my abilities. I decided to test my new abilities with my English teacher, Miss Eriks. I wanted to get her to move our upcoming test, not because I didn't know the material. Actually, quite the opposite. While I was studying for the test, I found out that I could memorize even the hardest pieces of literature, simply by scanning through the book. I just wanted to see if I could get her to do it. I noticed she's a dog lover, to the point of obsession. And, at this point, I had discovered that the best way to manipulate is to work with people's emotional attachments, their point of weakness. So, before class on the day of the big test, while everybody else was still filing in, I went to speak with her at her desk. I acted timid and sad as I shared a fake story about how my dog was sick and that he needed me to be there with him when they put him to sleep. Naturally, she understood my sentiments here. She told me how deeply sorry she felt and that I would be able to retake the test when I returned, but that's not what I wanted. Miss Eriks, how would you feel if you were putting your dog down and the whole world just kept on going as if nothing was wrong? She looked into my eyes and a vein started to pop in the middle of her forehead. I had struck a chord. I worked up some tears as I continued.
If it's not too much to ask, Miss Eriks, and maybe it is, but most people wouldn't understand what it's like to love a dog so deeply. But all I ask is that we take this class period as a moment of silence for Fido and all the other dogs who never got that recognition. The test can wait for that, can't it?
Now she had tears in her eyes as she looked over to the picture of her dog, which she got framed on her desk. She grabbed a tissue and blew her nose before turning to the class and announcing,
Class, today's test is postponed until tomorrow. Today's lesson is that sometimes there are things in life more important than sticking to a rigid schedule. Today, we take a moment of silence to send our best to Miss Sonia and her beloved dog Fido as they part ways. With her conclusion, she gave me a wink and gestured towards the door. That was my cue to leave. I put my hands on my heart as I said, thank you, and walked to my car.
That was all I needed to know that I could have everything. And I found that I could also manipulate my world in other, smaller ways too. Like, I could now do my makeup perfectly. It's actually just based on the principle of the golden ratio. Easy, right? And I was able to pick up any musical instrument and play it like I had been practicing since childhood. Just about anything and everything came easy for me. By my senior year, I had attracted a lot of attention. Teachers had prompted me to take an IQ test and, to no surprise, I scored as a genius. Because of that, all of the different school clubs wanted me to become a member. Other kids wanted me to be their tutor or join their study groups. And my parents and teachers were all so excited and proud, but I really didn't care. It just was what it was, and I was already wrapped in manipulating them all anyways. Plus, I no longer had any time to waste on experiencing those emotions. I could clearly see what they did to people, leaving them vulnerable to manipulation and all. Easy prey. I just knew that feelings were the ultimate trap. For years, I manipulated the world around me with no issue at all. And during those years, I had a ball doing it. I talked my parents into buying me a new car, got front row seats to sold out games, and free airline tickets around the world. Life was sweet. But like anything else, even that eventually got boring. I wanted something bigger and better, something new, a challenge. I wanted fame. So one night as I was sleeping, and at the same time solving an incredibly challenging math problem, an idea came to me. I would manipulate my way into getting on the biggest talent show in the country. With all of my new skills, I knew that I could have a very good chance of winning. And that would be the beginning of my fame and would give me the exposure I needed. I worked hard on crafting the right plan. I made several phone calls and sent emails, all to the right people who I knew would talk to the right people. And voila! One day, I got the call. They wanted me to audition for the show. If I was still indulging in primal human emotions, I would have felt nervous when I was facing such a large crowd and those judges, with those spotlights hitting me. But instead, I just felt ready to show them why I should win. I brought four different instruments out on stage and played them all to create a new remix for a popular song at that time. I knew by the looks on the judges' faces that I already had it in the bag, but that wasn't all. While I was playing the song, I told each of the judges exactly what they were thinking. Again, it just takes serious observation. I even managed to expose one of the meanest judges as a softie. I don't think he was happy about that, but he couldn't deny it. That sold them. I was on to the next round, and the next, until I won the whole thing. That was the closest I had felt to excitement since my injury. Although, maybe it was more like feeling a sense of accomplishment. By the end of that whole journey, people all over the country knew who I was.
I couldn't even go grocery shopping without somebody recognizing me. And everybody would say the same thing.
Oh my goodness! You're Sonia from America's Got Talent! Can you tell what I'm thinking now?
Everyone, that is. Until I met Ryan. One day, I was in line for a bagel at my favorite deli when a guy behind me tapped me on the shoulder. It started off like all the rest.
Hey, you're Sonia from America's Got Talent, right?
Yep, that's me, I replied, studying him so that I knew how to respond to his next question. But he took me by surprise when, instead, he asked,
can I tell you what you're thinking?
At that moment, I was thinking that this guy couldn't possibly know what I'm thinking. And that's exactly what he said. 4 years later, we got married. As it turned out, Ryan was just like me. However, he had become a genius after receiving electric shock therapy for his depression years ago. A lot of people come out of that treatment with a scrambled brain, but he somehow came out a genius. It felt so nice having someone around who understood me and could actually stimulate me. We would talk about things that would have made other people think we were crazy. Things that everybody should talk about, really. But instead, they're too busy fiddling around with their emotions. Stuff like, you know, existence. Another bonus of having Ryan in my life was that he was on the same mission. By the time we met, we were both millionaires. And now, we wanted to become billionaires. We were working on a project together that would create a foolproof space launch when I found out I was pregnant. And around the time of our first successful launch into space, our daughter, Sasha, launched herself onto Earth. For the first decade of her life, as harsh as it sounds, Sasha felt like a bit of an inconvenience. She demanded a great deal of attention, as all kids do, as well as emotional support, and, well, neither Ryan nor I had much patience nor empathy for those emotions. We did what we had to do in order to make sure that Sasha was taken care of. She had a good life, by most standards. We lived in a mansion, had beautiful cars and things. She could have anything she wanted, and she had a very lovely nanny who spent more time with her than either Ryan or I ever did. Who has time for that anyway? Most of my days happily consisted of work. By the time Sasha was 5 years old, not only had Ryan and I accomplished our dream of becoming billionaires, but we also were now ruling the world with our science labs and tech companies. Our companies were known and used by everyone, and we had enough influence in the world to do whatever we wanted. We were literally on top of the world. And still, I wanted more. But one day, when Sasha was 7 years old, I got a phone call from her school. There had been an accident on the playground, and she had fallen off the top of the slide and had broken her leg. She was okay, but she was in the emergency room. Ryan and I were on our way to a very important business meeting when we got that call. Maybe the biggest meeting with the biggest potential for us yet. Now, had you asked me a day earlier, I would have told you that nothing in the world could have made me possibly sabotage that meeting by leaving. But right there and then, something inside of me felt different. And to my own disbelief, I chose to go and see Sasha at the hospital instead. The whole way there, I was feeling things stirring inside of me. My chest was swirling with movement. From what I could remember, I believe it was a pure sense of motherhood worry that I've, perhaps, never allowed myself to experience. And when I got there and saw Sasha asleep and all bandaged up, I broke down for the first time in well over a decade. I couldn't hold it back anymore. I cried, really cried. And not because I wanted to manipulate anything or get my way, but because I loved Sasha. And I'm now a bit ashamed to admit to you that I had never really felt that love before that moment. It was right there and then that the most important lesson I'd ever learned hit me. And that's saying a lot as a genius. Money and fame mean nothing. Not in the grand scheme. There will never be enough to satisfy you. Ever. Only authentic, loving connection and lived knowledge, which some would call wisdom, bring true value to life. In that hospital room, holding the hand of my sweet, beautiful daughter, I finally felt like the wealthiest person in the world.